I'm John Avlon, and this is Reality Check on the Extremist Beat, in part two of our extended look at the rise of white identity politics with CNN's Elle Reeve and Sara Sidner. This is perhaps the most politically powerful form of divisive tribalism in America today. But recruiters for these extremist groups understand that they can't sell themselves as blatant racists on the surface, like the KKK of old. That would be too obvious and alienating and bad for business. So they use memes and phrases like white pride and European heritage to recruit people into their cause. In the case of one young woman we'll meet next, she was drawn to the superficially clean-cut image and the promise of belonging. It wasn't until she was attending a backyard book burning that she saw how things had taken a very dark turn, made more obvious by the threats and slurs she endured when she tried to leave the group.
On January 1st, 2017, you became a member of Identity Europa. Can you explain what that is?
It was a white civil rights group, or a white advocacy group, I believe was the term. Identity Europa was trying to project this image of being, clean cut, law abiding, non-racial slur using, polite, kind, handing out water bottles to old ladies on the street. Just like a nice group of people.
They didn't want to look like the skinheads.
No, absolutely not. The language that was used was always pro-white. It was never anti-anything else. And so it made it really easy to ignore the parts that you don't want to see.
Like violence.
Yeah, violence or just blatant racism.
Today known as the American Identity Movement, Identity Europa was created in 2016 as a kind of fraternity to promote white power with a more clean-cut face.
It's all very old, very antiquated ideology, just packaged in khakis and loafers.
Khakis and loafers. Ellie, I mean, what is so striking is the pitch is, on the surface, she's saying, so positive, clean-cut, law-abiding, well-dressed, polite. But there's a much darker edge to it that comes out pretty quickly, doesn't there?
Well, absolutely. I mean, the leader of that group sent me a picture of his testicles, so.
And
yeah.
Then there's that.
great guys. So people like Richard Spencer or Jared Taylor, as Sara interviewed, the problem they saw was that white nationalism had the stigmas of being attached to people who were poor or uneducated. And what they wanted to do is make racism aspirational. You like look like a cool guy, look like a guy in GQ. And that would bring more people, especially men who felt they had low self-esteem, felt they didn't have a place in society. They felt that would bring more people to the movement. And it was very successful.
That is something we hear over and over again on the extremist beat, is this deep need for belonging, attracting people who are deeply insecure and giving them the veneer of dignity and morals while making it easier to part with them. In the second part of your interview we're about to play, she finds out it's a lot darker, a lot quicker. That's when we return.
We took a weekend and went to a bunch of parties in New York.
What kind of parties?
Nazi parties.
And this is the type of awful tool.
I went to a book burning. That was pretty scandalous. It's all so surreal. Like, you're literally standing there going, I'm at a book burning in someone's house. Like, there are families that live next door. There's probably a nice person who lives across the street, and I'm burning books about Jewish people. Like, it was just so, I don't know, it just feels wet. Like, it doesn't even feel like it's wrong or right. It just feels unreal.
So, Ellie, I mean, Nazi parties, book burnings. This isn't terribly subtle, but is what she described to you and what you've seen in your reporting really a matter of sort of the frog in the boiling pot of water, that all of a sudden they find themselves at a Nazi party and a book burning? And if so, why the hell don't they leave the party at that point?
Oh, that's actually very interesting. A big part of a distinguishing characteristic on the online version of this kind of racism is it all starts with jokes. it's just a little joke, and you can blow it off like, oh, they don't really mean it. We're talking Holocaust jokes, whatever. And I have heard those jokes in my life, but they took on more power and they got darker on the internet. And over time, as you're washed in these jokes over and over and over, you become immune to it. And as Samantha told me, eventually you realize you believe it. So you're no longer shocked by it. The second half of that is that because there is still a stigma, thankfully, on being an explicit racist in America, these guys all knew each other's true identities. And so they were always holding over each other the threat that they would dox them, that they would expose them for who they really were. And then for the rest of their lives, they would have to carry the stigma of having been white nationalists. So that was a way that they could sort of keep everyone in line and keep them locked into the ideology.
That's fascinating and sinister and totally, it's a cult tactic. It's hunting for heretics. You make an example of the person who leaves the group to keep everybody else in line. Sara, you've done a lot of reporting on a lot of extremist groups over the course of your career. And to what extent is white identity politics, which is a polite term, not just for racism, but white nationalism, white supremacy, to what extent is that a flow through all or most of the extremist groups you've covered?
It's a huge part of it. And I think the reason why is that people are always looking for power in these groups. They're looking to bring more money. They're looking to bring more attention, but positive attention, to try and get into the annals of power. And so when you do that, you have to modify your message. And like Ellie said, it really has been a PR game, if you will. The khakis and tiki torches instead of, you know, hoods and burning crosses. So if you can start tailoring your message to make it sound a little bit more palatable, and then a little bit more, and then a little bit more, you can let that seep into people's fears that already exist in this country. This country has a long history that it's still struggling with when it comes to racism. And slowly, slowly, you can sort of expand that by once getting into people's minds with things like memes, very popular, with things like joking, quote unquote, dark jokes, racist jokes, anti-Semitic jokes. And you can play that off, especially on the internet, as if you're just joking. Those memes are targeted at everyone, but they're particularly targeted at children, or they work quite well with children because they're so subtle. They're funny. They look like cartoons. They look like a comic.
They've studied the way that our young men interact online, and they have looked at what these boys need, and they have learned how to fill those needs in order to entice them into propaganda.
This mother had done some writing on all sorts of things, the men's rights movement, and she started to recognize some of the language that her son was saying to her, and it was hurtful.
The first word I heard was triggered, and this is a tough one, because you'll hear this from your conservative uncle, and you may also hear this from a kid that's getting a lot of alt-right messaging online, and that's, everyone's too sensitive today, and that's a very alt-right talking point that is an entryway kind of terminology. It's not racist, no it's not, but it's often used against people who are calling out racism or sexism or homophobia as a way to imply that, you know, those of us who don't accept that language are just too sensitive.
Her teen, like others we've talked to, was drawn in by snarky memes. She and her son scrolled through his Instagram Explore feed, which recommends content based on what it thinks a user will enjoy. She was stunned.
And I saw an image of Hitler, and I stopped him, and I said, wait, was that Hitler?
It was a meme implying a time traveler would have tipped Hitler off to keep him alive.
I know my kids understand Hitler, but as I scrolled through his, I saw more memes that joked about the Holocaust and joked about slavery.
So normalizing.
Yeah. And desensitizing our kids to things we should be sensitive to.
Yeah, you don't expect Hitler to show up in your kids' feed.
No.
Sara, I mean, one of the things that characterizes your reporting on the extremist beat is an attempt at finding genuine empathy, understanding where people come from. And for some of these folks, the slippery slope, ironically, is this feeling of defensiveness, this feeling of being judged, this feeling, ironically, of being marginalized. And it makes them susceptible to some of this rhetoric. Do you think that's the gateway drug, in effect?
Yes, because it speaks to something very human, and that is being marginalized. That is being seen as a person in a negative light just because the color of your skin, right? We've been here. We've done this. We know what this feels like. And so if you start off with that and you start to feel that, look, I'm being targeted and being thought of in a negative light because of just I happen to be born with white skin. That's something that I can understand as a person of color. That's something I can understand. And the reason why I want to understand what someone is feeling who is in that position is because when we get right down to the human aspects of all this, there are some subtleties that we need to recognize, no matter what, you know, what your thoughts are on, you know, the political movements that are happening, what your thoughts are on the Black Lives Matter movement, what your thoughts are on any of the things that are happening now with social justice, for example. There has to be some space to recognize the fears of white folks. I've been slayed for recognizing that. I've been slayed for being, quote unquote, understanding, if you will. But what I'm trying to understand and get to the root of is, what's the solution to this? And if we don't listen to what people's fears are, then this is just going to tumble and tumble and tumble and get worse and worse and worse. Those fears grow. Those fears turn into resentments. Those resentments turn into actions.
That's brilliantly put and exactly right. It's about transcending tribalism. It's about an identity politics rooted in our common humanity, not our common fears, and recognizing those with empathy so we can all ultimately recognize each other as Americans.
Darkness does not defeat darkness. Only light can do that, right?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
That's where we are. But there are young folks who are like, look, that's old generation shit, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
We're not going to sit here and take this. We're not going to get dogs sicked on us. So it's an interesting dichotomy. But at some point, that anger has to be channeled. Otherwise, everything's blowing up all of the time. And it's going to be channeled. And, you know, we'll see.
And what the accelerationists, of course, want explicitly is a race war.
Absolutely. They want to channel that anger into an explosion, then have the reason to come in and fight back. And when I say fight back, you hit them with a feather, they'll hit you with a Uzi.
That's the aggressive defensiveness that was used by the Klan during Reconstruction. They would start a fight and use it to justify a massacre.
Yeah.
Ellie and Sarah, we're going to have to leave it there, but this is such a fascinating and important conversation. And because of your reporting over a period of years, I think it's more possible than ever to pull the curtain back, as it were, beneath some of these shiny slogans to see the historic racism that lurks beneath it. So thank you both very much for joining us on Reality Check, Extremist Beat, as always.